off a message I started last week about the chair of choice. And essentially I had two chairs, and I changed them through the message last week, and I messed with some people because I said this chair was the chair of choosing beforehand, and this was the random chair that you sort of choose to make a decision when something happens, and depending on how you're feeling at the time will depend on whether your decision you make. But this one was a chair that you would sit in and choose beforehand, and how you're going to react and what's going to happen. And I spoke about how in this chair, you know, you'd sit in here and you'd think to yourself, before God speaks, before I hear the word of God, or when I hear it, I've already chosen that I'm going to do what he's asking. I'm going to say, yes, Lord. Whereas this chair, well, I might be sitting in here and think to myself, well, I'll wait and see what's happening at the time. I'll see how I feel. And I use the example that, you know, in our family, we sat down with the kids and we said, we go to church on a Sunday. That's what we do. And we'd already chosen. And so we got up and we went to church on a Sunday. If I was sitting in this chair of random choice, I'd get up on a Sunday and then think, oh, I can't be bothered. And I'd hardly go. You know? And same with giving, and same with, there's a whole lot of things. And so it had some, there's some positive things with this, and it could have been a negative thing. Like you say, well, I see this. If I see this guy in the street, I'm going to smack him up the chops. You know, that's not such a good thing. You don't want to, you think to yourself, no, I choose to love people before I met them. And I sort of did that. I chose to have the fruit of the Holy Spirit in my life. I'd go to work and I'd say, thank you, Lord, that I have the fruit of the Holy Spirit in my life, and it's going to be evident. And I'd pre-choose to have that rather than choose at the time. Because you see, if I got up in the morning and thought, you know what, I feel grumpy today, I'm going to be grumpy. And everyone's just going to have to accept that. And if they can't see by my face that I'm grumpy and look out, that's their problem. Instead, I thought, no, I choose to have joy in my life instead of grumpy. But sometimes I didn't wake up with my joy, but I had to do it anyway. So I want to start off by reading Psalm 100. Shout joyfully. Now, in Hebrew, which is what this is written as a psalm, you know, in English we have abstract ideas, so no. Oh. That's my wife. So, with messages, essentially, you know, any message you hear from anybody on anything, it will not be the definitive final word on stuff, particularly if it's biblical stuff. You won't, you know, no person can really know the full extent and everything, and God's just revealed everything to you, because we only see in part now. We only see a shadow of things as they are, and so you can't possibly speak. So it's only a little part. It's and I wanted to use this word today, and I was trying to think of how I was going to do it. It says, but they're just a small part in the tapestry of a biblically based subject. tapestry is the word for today. But, you know, it is just a small part of it, and God pieces it together. And what you'll notice is with the body of Christ is that the more we get together and in unity in the body of Christ, the more we bring our part and the picture becomes clearer. But a message is just, you're just hearing a small part of it, and we listen to messages with the Holy Spirit, just like we read Scripture. When you read the Bible, you read the Bible with the Holy Spirit, and you ask Him, is there anything that you are wanting to speak to me about? And there may be some very challenging things, very challenging aspects, and I may have chosen a subject and may have chosen a particular part of that subject, but the Holy Spirit may speak to you quite differently, and you might even get offended by me, even though it's the Holy Spirit that's speaking to you. So if you get offended today, it's the Holy Spirit, not me. That's basically where I was going with that. But there may be some very challenging things, and it's good for us to be challenged. It's good for us to have our habits and our actions and our thoughts and the way we talk and listen challenged at times. It's really good for us, because you may have just been going down the same path with on a subject for all your life, and you just can never get anywhere beyond that. It's just like this old horse and cart, and it's going down this old rutted road, and you can't move. And I had heard some messages in the past about some things, and I thought, oh, well, that's it. And I put it to bed in my heart, and that was it. And then someone came and spoke something else, and I thought, I've been missing something that has made this subject a bit fuller and a bit better. Some of them were outright wrong, what I thought. And so my intellect was trying to get me to think some things, but it's good to be challenged. It's good to be shifted. And, it might only be a small shift in your life. And if you're sailing on I use this for Nigel. If you're sailing from Auckland to San Diego and you are half a degree off, you will be a long way off by the time you'll be in Peru somewhere. I think I got that right, I'm just making it up. But you'll be a long way off course. But you know, if God wants to slowly move us and clock us around to more towards Him, it's only a little bit at a time. Just a wee bit at a time. So that's sort of thing, as we listen to these messages and we consider, we just want to consider things and say, Lord, is there something that you want to speak to me about? So last week I talked about a lady called Hagar. And you often don't hear much about Hagar. She was the mistress, no, she was the maidservant of Sarah. And Sarah and Abraham, they were called out of the land that they were in, and they went to a land that God said, go to this land and I'll make you a great nation. And He gave them a big promise. And it had been 25 years or whatever it was, and they still hadn't had a child. There's no way for this promise to be fulfilled. And so Sarah came up with this cunning plan. She thought, I will help God to fulfill His plan. And so she said to Abraham, well, here's my maidservant Hagar. She can be your wife, and I'll have kids through her. And so Abraham went along with it, as most men will do, I guess. She got pregnant. But then she looked down her nose. She saw Sarah as insignificant after that. She despised her. And then Sarah got a bit aggravated and blamed Abraham, and said that, you know, it's your fault. And Abraham's like, you know, and so he doesn't stand up for anybody and much and all that and all this. And so he says, just do whatever you like to Hagar. And so she treats her badly, and Hagar runs off, and she goes back to, he's heading back to Egypt. But something in the heart of Hagar has attracted God to her. Something in the heart of Hagar. Hagar is quite obviously quite an amazing woman, and God speaks to her, and she immediately got up. She was on her way to Egypt back home. She immediately got up and went back to Sarah. The angel of the Lord said to her, go back and submit yourself to your mistress Sarah. And I said last week that's the same root of the word submit in Hebrew is affliction. So you could say, go back and submit yourself to the affliction of your mistress Sarah. Now, don't you pray for sweet relief, eh? I pray for sweet relief from stuff like this. And I don't want to, you know, but why does God want to get me in these situations that make my life uncomfortable? He's quite annoying sometimes like that, eh? And you just wonder, what, Lord, and I'm praying, please deliver me, Lord Jesus. And I don't want to hear Him say, no, you stay there and overcome it. I don't want to hear that. I don't like speaking messages like this. I don't want to hear them. And as I say, I especially don't want to speak them. But Hagar got up immediately and went back as she was asked by the Lord. Now, if she'd gone to Egypt, would she have left behind the inheritance that Ishmael, her son, would have got from Abraham? Yes. Now, if she had disobeyed the Lord and kept going to Egypt, would she have missed out on the word that God had for her and Ishmael if she had gone to Egypt and not gone back? Well, yes. And half the time we are doing this as well, aren't we? Is we are running away from God and we think we're just running away from the hard mahi that he wants us to do, but really we're running away also from the blessing and the goodness of God and the resourcing of God as well. So this message is one of... You know, when God speaks, we can choose beforehand to sit in this chair. And I see how I have the same chair, Nat? See, I've been able to, same chair as I didn't swap chairs. Yeah, yeah, she said it messed with her last time because I swapped chairs accidentally. But we choose this chair that said, if God speaks, I'm going to do what he's asking me to do, regardless of how I feel. I've already decided. And Hagar did that. In 2 Chronicles 16:9, it says, the eyes of the Lord go out throughout all the earth looking for those people whose hearts are completely his, because he wants to strongly support them. Hagar must have been one of those people. And I thought to myself, you know, Hagar's probably, you know, if it was me and I was Hagar, that's unlikely because I'm not a woman, but, you know, if just use your imagination for a moment. I would have thought to myself, Lord, you need to sort Sarah out. But the reality is that if we are obedient to the Lord, we have to trust that he is going to sort out those people that he is calling us to go back to. And you know, this is such a good thing, but she went back and she didn't complain, and it was pretty awesome. If we look at the life of Jesus, we see that sometimes he hid himself. Sometimes he stood up, sometimes he sat down, sometimes he spoke up, sometimes he didn't. Sometimes he submitted and sometimes he grabbed the whip and drove people out of the temple. But he did everything that he saw the Father doing and said everything that he heard the Father saying. And it's really important for us to understand that we also need to be those people that when God calls us to stand up, we stand up. But if he calls us to sit down, we sit down. Speak up, not speak up. You know, to go or to stay, or to go back to the affliction or not. Because, you know, you have to admit that you learn the most when you go through difficult times, when you're under the pump. You learn very little when it's comfortable, eh? You know? So if Jesus did it, then it's good for us. So God would work on Sarah and Abraham. Will your heart melt when God speaks to you? You know, I have made the choice that say, oh, Lord, I pray that you'd help me, that my heart would melt when you speak to me, rather than becoming hard or stiff-necked like some of the Israelites did. He called to them, and they were stiff-necked. They wouldn't turn around and look at him. And it's so much easier, honestly, when we, in the Sunday morning, there was no question about us going to church. The kids didn't question it. Well, sometimes they did, but we just, well, oh, we go to church. And it was just easy. I got up and went to church. It's like getting up and going to work. You don't, you know, if you lie around in bed thinking about, oh, work sucks, and, you know, oh, Johnny, and this person, and that, you know, you won't get up and you go. You just stay in bed. And after a while, 3 years later, you're thinking, oh, I wonder if I've still got my job. Why am I getting paid? But will your heart melt? Go back to him and submit to your mistress, Sarah, who was treating you poorly. Submit to her and the affliction that she is giving you. Why do we have to learn to overcome? Because if you're going to be an overcomer, you've got to overcome something. Might as well be whatever it is we're facing. But you know, I'll use this because of what's happened this week, but if you realize that tragedy is going to be, it's part of life. Life and death, you know, death is going to be part of this life. But if you can choose to say to the Lord, you know what, Father? No matter what I face, I'm going to stand firm, and I'm going to stand on the rock of my salvation. No matter what I face, I am going to stand in your name, and I'm not going to fall apart like a $2 suitcase. You know, that's what chair I want to sit in. You can be prepared. It's not you want to be morbid and all that sort of stuff, but it's really being prepared. Because you see, if something happens and you aren't prepared in Jesus' name, it's never going to be at a convenient time. Sunday rolls around way too quick, eh? you know, if I'm just sitting in this random thing, I will see on Sunday, or I'll see how I'm feeling if God calls, or I'll see how I'm feeling when God says, I want you to put that cash you've just got into the offering. You know, I felt that this morning. I picked up this cash this morning and thinking, yeah, boy, with a cash. And the Lord said, oh, I'll put it in the offering. And I, you know, this strange deafness came over me. But I did it. Even Deirdre said, what are you doing? But maybe he's calling you to stay, to go, to talk, to stay quiet, or to go back. And, you know, Jesus was, and this really messes with you when you think about it, but Jesus was taken by the Holy Spirit out into the desert to be tempted by Satan. Hey? Hey? Why would he do that? Well, they were testing the quality of what was inside Jesus. You know, it's a bit like God, he prepares us for what's coming in the future, and then he tests the quality of what that preparedness, and then we actually come across the situation that he's preparing us for. But if we're not prepared to submit to him and sit in this chair of predetermining your choice, you may end up having trouble when the real time comes, when the real season comes, when whatever's coming. And it's not until you move into the new season that you realize, oh, now I see. So he's testing the quality of what's inside. And Mike Connell spoke about God wants to grow warriors, people who can stand firm and to overcome no matter what they're going through. And, you know, we're fighting a war, and we don't fight against flesh and blood, but against the principalities and powers of this dark age. And But I want to smack up the chops, the person who's doing that to me. But you need to look beyond the humanity and see what it is that's operating behind and what's happening. Maybe you're being tested. And I'm not saying that everything that happens is a test, but it certainly does test you with all the stuff that happens. But we seem to grow and mature most when we're under the pump. Now, as with most concepts or ideas or truths like this, we will no doubt have to experience them and overcome them or have a revelation from God to see it and to grow through it. Because you just don't realize what God is preparing you for, you know, that sometimes you can just... You see, well, let me give you an example, I spoke this last week for those who weren't here, but if God calls you to be a missionary in China, and you can do a couple of things. One, you can just buy a ticket and go, and sort it out when you get there. Number two, you can sit around waiting for God to open the doors. Or three, you can go and learn the Chinese language, figure out the culture. Where am I going to go? Where's the funding going to come from? Are there any missionary organizations in China already in that place? Have they failed? Have they succeeded? Who's running them and what's going on? There's a lot of stuff you can do to prepare and get ready. And when God calls us, and I've noticed this with a lot of words for myself and for other people, God is giving us a hint about what's coming in the future, and he wants to see, and it's a bit of a test, are we going to get prepared for what he's calling us to? Because you might have to. it's sort of really important. It's where you listen. I love listening to you know, the words that God has for people, because I take some notes. He prepares us for the future and the next season. Are we prepared to get prepared? Now, a few weeks ago, I spoke about a message about Jacob and Esau. And if you know, Sarah and Abraham had a son of promise eventually, when Abraham was 100. He was 75 when he was called to this new country, and he gets there and there's a famine. But God, you called me to this new place. What do you mean there's a famine here? Well, God was about to break the famine, but Abraham, he became the father of faith, but he wasn't then. He had to learn and grow through it. God was preparing him and getting him ready. But he went down to Egypt and ended up getting that slave woman, Hagar, or maid servant. I'm a slave, doesn't sound so good, but maid servant for Sarah, and that's where they all came from. But anyway, they had the son of promise called Isaac, and he had a couple of twins, and called Jacob and Esau. And you may remember that Esau despised, so just like Hagar looked down her nose at Sarah, when Hagar got pregnant and Sarah wasn't, it was that same word that they use in the Bible. So Esau despised in the same way that Hagar despised Sarah. So you could say that Hagar bought all of it on herself, even though Sarah started it. Man, we make things complicated. And then it's Abraham's fault, of course, and it's time to go to Egypt. Hallelujah. But but Esau despised it. He despised the inheritance, but really he was despising the inheritance that God had given Abraham to Isaac and was going to be passed on, but he despised it. He looked down his nose on it. It was insignificant. So he chose another path. Jacob, you know, became Esau for a short time, tricked his dad and got the inheritance. And it's sort of an interesting story. But when they came back together later in life, Jacob had been through all sorts of stuff. He wanted to get a wife. And so he went to work for his uncle or whoever it was. And he loved Rebecca or Rachel. I can't remember which one it was. One of them. And he loved them and he wanted to marry them. But the father-in-law, the future father, said, "You're going to have to work 7 years to get her." But it went past as just a day because Jacob was so in love. And anyway, he had a bit too much to drink, and he woke up in the morning and found it's the wrong one, the other sister. Oops. So then he had to work another 7 years to get the one he actually wanted. He'd been through, this is tough, man, 14 years. And then he'd had wrestled with God, he'd had a hip thing done, and he'd limping. He had been through some difficulties. You know, God eventually changed his name to Israel, give him a new identity. But now he's come back together with his brother Esau. And Jacob is a bit concerned, but there's something has happened to Jacob and something has gone on with Esau. When you look at the Hebrew language and how they speak to each other, Esau speaks harshly and is hard and is very bitter. Jacob, he comes in, or Israel, he comes in very low and very humbly. He says, "I am your servant. All I have is yours." The language in the Hebrew is so different. And basically what's happened is that Esau has chosen a path that's away from where God, away from God, and now he's bitter and he's twisted and he's hard and a hard man. But Jacob has become sweet. He has become a much better person, a person closer to Jesus than what Esau did. And this is the choices we choose. He chose. You know, Esau chose to go in the other direction. And Jacob, and you may recall in, you know, the Israelites are going from Egypt to the Promised Land, and there's a couple of instances they come across this poison water. One is at Meribah, and there is at Marah. And the one at Marah, God shows Moses a tree, and he says, "Put the tree in the water, and it'll become sweet." And this tree speaks of the cross of Jesus. And you come to the cross of Jesus Christ, and you know all that it, you understand all that Jesus did, and there's a sweetness that comes into your life. But if you choose to ignore that because you are like Esau and you despise it, you look down your nose on it, it's insignificant, you end up in a place where there's death and curses. Death, darkness, decrease, or bitterness. And the other way with Jesus is life, light, and increase, and it's sweet. You become sweet. The waters in your life become sweet. And it's really obvious. I hadn't sort of realized this when I looked at this. Studying the language that they used, Esau and Jacob, it is totally different. Jacob is a different person, but Esau is bitter and he's twisted, and he still doesn't value the word of God. He doesn't value the inheritance that God has for him. And of course, it's so important that if we're looking to live in the Spirit, how do we get perspective? If we're not looking to live in the Spirit, how do we get perspective on natural things that are temporary? Because if you're living inside those temporary, material, humanistic things, you will see them as valuable. When you're living in the Spirit, you it's kind of like you're a bit outside of that, and you look back and you realize that they're not important. But Esau had chosen the natural things, material things, but he hadn't chosen to value the Word of God like Jacob did. Hagar, she valued the word of God. She got up immediately and went back to the affliction. Now, it says a lot about what Hagar's heart. It says a lot about that lady. And it's quite amazing. The angel of the Lord says to her, "Hagar, Sarah's slave woman." That's what he called her. "From where have you come and where are you going?" Often God asks us these questions because he wants to draw out of our heart what's actually going on. And you can't lie to God, so you can't make, "Oh, well, I'm just going for a, I'm having a tour." Are ya? Would you like to change your answer? If God asked you to change your answer, do you want to change it to the truth? Hey. You know, God's spoken to me a couple of times, you know, sort of like this audible voice, and man, you has asked me a couple of questions, and they're quite a hard choice, but you know that there's only one answer that's right, but your flesh is resisting it with everything it has, because it wants to get revenge and retribution, and it wants to, anyway. But why would God want Hagar to go back? Why would he want us to suffer some affliction, and why would he want Hagar to? Well, you know, I don't know half the time. I'm not sure. You know, if I knew, I'd say, but I don't. I just don't understand sometimes. Maybe when I look back, I might have a better understanding and an idea, but what I do know is that I learn to overcome. And you look at in Revelation, there's seven churches, and they each get a letter, and it says at the end of them, to him who over, or the person who overcomes, here is a reward. It's almost as if we're going through things on this earth to see whether we are, you know, what they're testing the quality of what's inside of us to see what's going to happen afterwards. Now, that's an interesting concept. I know there's a reward for all Christians. I get that. But there's something else going on. And Jesus tells a parable about the people with talents. And he gives more to the one, to some, than not to the one who buried it. It was taken off him. You think about what that means. It's not all about what's happening here on earth. It's about what goes on after. And it's scary. I don't like messages like this. I don't want to hear that. But we learn the most when we go through difficulty. In the book of Deuteronomy, the word submit is used in that same way that was used with Hagar. And it's the God's talking to them, and the Bible says that he humbled and tested you in the desert. He humbled and tested you in the desert. He tested them with poison waters. They turn up to this place. Oh, look, there's some water, and it's poison. It's bitter. He tests them. What's going to happen? What are you going to do? And, of course, most of them fall apart like a $2 suitcase. You know, and I have probably done that a few times in my life. But, you know, I've been trying to make this choice here, and it's hard to sit in this chair where I'm going to say, you know what, Lord, no matter what happens, I'm going to try. I want to stand firm. I want to overcome. You know, maybe I need to do that for the people that are around me that are really suffering and that are really grieving about some things. Our battle isn't against flesh and blood, but against the principalities and powers of this dark age, things that stand against the knowledge of God. Sometimes we are in the refiner's fire, and it's a hard and hot place to be. You know, nobody likes their butt getting burnt. But what happens when you're in the refiner's fire, the imperfections, the imperfections, I know exactly what, and I apologize. That just came out. You know, where the Lord says that there's a lot of words, sin abounds. And it's just abounded. It's just abounded. What's that? Oh, okay. But you know, the dross or the imperfections, the impurities all come to the surface, and then you have to deal with them. You can't just leave them. You need to get rid of them. And if we don't deal with the impurities and the things that come up in our life, we can end up with it can be tough. Because God will it's like a bad curry. Just keeps on repeating on you. Just keeps on coming up. And then it might do other things. So it's better just to deal with this stuff, because you might find that you're just constantly butting up against the same old thing. No matter where you go and what you do, it's the same old stuff until you deal with what God is calling you to deal with. And that's what it's like being in the refiner's fire. Or you can choose the path of bitterness that Esau was on, and others in the Bible rejected God and they chose a path of bitterness. Now, did they think, oh, it's going to be bitter off down that path? Oh, well. No, they were, you know, they thought, oh, this is awesome. It's this, I want to go here. I don't, this, that's dumb. But, that, you know, Jacob made a choice that was different. What? Oh, yeah, bitter off. Did I say that? Oh, that's awesome. Oh, I'm bitter off going down that path. Oh, that's so good. Yeah. Sometimes I pray the Lord would make me funny without me knowing. Yeah, it may not be so much of God, unfortunately. But, you know, there's no matter where God calls us to, he wants to fully resource us. And no matter what he's called us to, and I think to myself, well, what was Hagar's life like when she returned? The thing is, you see, when you come into submission and alignment with God about what he's calling you to do, he gives you the wherewithal to deal with whatever it is. Because faith comes by hearing, and you've heard this word of God and you're acting on it. Now you're just like, wow, I can deal with this. I can handle it. Lord, you sort out Sarah, not me. We saw what happened when Sarah tried to sort out stuff for God. That didn't go so well. And 1 Thessalonians, I was going to say something else then, but it's actually Thessalonians. Enter his gates with a song of thanks. Not it. Shall I just read it out? I don't know. Anyway. For God has not called us to impurity, but to holiness. That is to be dedicated and set apart by behavior that pleases him, whether in public or private. So whoever rejects and disregards this is not merely rejecting man, but God, who gives us his Holy Spirit, or gives the Holy Spirit to you, to dwell in you and empower you to overcome temptation. Now, this is talking about sexual impurity, but there's a parallel with some other things in our lives. You know, when we're hearing from God or we're reading this scripture, we're hearing a message and the Holy Spirit speaking to us, you might get offended by what I say, and I apologize for that, but you may not be rejecting just what I'm saying. You may be rejecting what the Holy Spirit is saying through me or through the scripture or whatever. And this is really, as I say, talking about sexual impurity, but people find it difficult to hear certain things, especially in our culture and society today, where it's all about tolerance of various things and various people. But the reality is that God is pretty specific about a lot of things. But do we stand up and do we fight over it, or do we sit down? Do we hide? What do we do? Well, that's God. You know, we need to ask the Lord, what do you want me to do in these situations? But we have to all be careful that we're not, it's not the person we're rejecting. We could be rejecting God's word for us. You know, I remember Rod spoke about this a while ago, and he talked about, where is Rod? Oh, Rod. Hi there. And he spoke about, you know, not looking at the person who's giving the message, but look beyond that. And I thought it was such a good message, because often we look at the person giving the message, and you know, sometimes God chooses someone who's really offensive to give us a message. You ever notice that? What's he doing? But why am I offended by this person? Why would he choose that person? Well, he's testing the quality of what's inside. Now, in Job, there's a couple of key messages in Job, and I did threaten to say something about Job last week. But there's a couple of key messages in Job. One of them is this, that, you know, the devil is before God, and they're talking about Job, and he says to God, you know, the reason I can't get to Job is because you have a hedge of protection around him. If you remove that hedge of protection around Job, I will show you that I can break him. He will curse you and reject you. Now, God seems to have a lot more faith in Job than what Job does. And I would say he has a lot more faith in us, you and I, than what we have in ourselves and what we can handle. But this hedge of protection, part of it you could say is that it's where Jesus says you won't be tempted beyond what you can bear. So that's part of that, what that is. But here this situation develops, and the devil takes everything away from Job. All the material stuff, all his family, everything goes from him. Yet the Bible says in all this, he didn't sin. He didn't curse God. And it said that he was a righteous and pure guy with integrity beforehand. But what happened was all that happened proved that he was like this. And the devil said, the only reason he's loving you and serving you and following you is because of the hedge of protection that's around him. You take that away and you watch what happens. His humanity will overtake the spirit, and he will end up cursing you and sinning. And God said, just don't touch the man. And so the devil took everything away. But what happened? Well, he still didn't curse God and he didn't sin. But all of him and his mates sat around arguing about how Job must have sinned. Well, you must have sinned because God's punishing you. Job said, but I haven't sinned. Well, you must have. And now you're sinning about saying you haven't been sinning. And now that's a sin. So that's your sin. and all this sort of stuff. And they have this argument that goes back and forth, and it's quite intense. And then God comes in and he corrects and disciplines all of them because he says, you know nothing. You've all got peanut brains. You don't understand how Leviathan works. Do you know how Leviathan, you know, walks along the earth and how it does this and this creature does that? And they're all like, no. He says, no, you don't. You leave God's stuff to me and you just get on with what I have called you to. Stay in your lane. But Job, even though that stuff was taken away from Job, he didn't curse God and he didn't sin because something else was more important to Job than all the stuff. It was his relationship with the Lord. He knew that if I'm with God, all the stuff, it's like I'm really sad. And he sat there with sackcloth on and ashes on his head. You know, imagine doing that down at the shops. People would ask a few questions, you know. Then you have a few mates turn up and they have a discussion about how you've sinned. People are going, whoa, these guys need to be committed. But Job's heart was fully God's. And I would imagine that Hagar's heart was fully God's as well, in the same way, because she was being obedient. So let me ask you this question. What keeps us in God? What keeps us? Is it all the stuff? Is it the blessing? Or is it our relationship with him? That you see, when we are grieving, and I've experienced this week, when you are grieving and you're sad, you realize that it's just like that picture of, you're walking in on the beach with Jesus, and then suddenly there's only one set of footprints. And he's carrying you, but you don't always realize. But I've experienced that this week. Grief tried to overtake me, and I was sad, but I realized that, I want to stand up and overcome, and I want to be strong for Pete, and I want to be strong for God. And sometimes, when tragedy strikes, you can feel like, you know what, it is just, life is just not worth it. This tries to overwhelm you and overcome you. Life is not worth it. Why would I bother? Let me withdraw. Let me become a hermit. Or let me die. And Job kind of got to this point where, Lord, you might as well let me die. I want sweet relief. But, you know, God, just hang on a little bit longer, Job, and it was all restored. All the stuff that didn't mean as much to Job as what it means to some people was restored to him. If it doesn't matter to you, God can give it to you, and you're not going to become an idol in your life. So what are we seeking and wanting? The devil, Satan, in the same way with Jesus, tempted Jesus out in the desert. When he realized he couldn't get to him, he thought, the Bible says he left him for a more opportune moment. And you know what I think he thought to himself? I know how I'm going to get you. What's really important to you is your people who are called by your name. I'm going to get them to reject you and betray you and kill you, and let's just see where your heart's at now. Let's see what happens to your flesh. I know what flesh is like. The devil knows as well as anyone else. If I get your own people to reject you, to despise you, to crucify you in the most hideous way possible, let's see what happens to your heart then. And but what did Jesus do? He allowed himself to die in order for his seed to be sown into this earth, so out of it could come a spiritual harvest, the Holy Spirit. And so when a Christian's life, nothing is ever wasted. When a Christian passes on, it's like their physical life has been sown into this world, into the earth, but out of it comes a spiritual harvest. And we are believing that for Peter. Absolutely, and for all of us. We believe that. It's never the end. God doesn't waste anything. And of course, Jesus, he is tested to the very limit. We go from glory to glory, but sometimes in between the glories can be a bit of a valley. But that's when we need each other. If you're off on your own being an island, it's pretty tough. But ultimately, we want to keep our eyes set on the ultimate glory, which is being with our Father in heaven, to be with Jesus, our Lord and Savior. That is what keeps, I look up to Jesus and I think, man, that's what keeps me going. And that's why I choose to sit in this chair, to decide that when he speaks to me, I want to be obedient, no matter what's going on in my life, because often it's not going to come at a convenient time. But I want to choose that. I want to choose to have the fruit of the Holy Spirit in my life every day rather than choose to be grumpy or bitter. I don't want to go down the bitter path, even if it seems bitter, better. Let me finish with this. Here's the fruit of the Holy Spirit. Now, if you have the Holy Spirit living in you, you have this. It's like if you have a curry living in you, you have certain things in you. And everybody may know. And in the same way, you have these things. If you have the Holy Spirit in you, you have these things in you. And every morning you can say, "Thank you, Jesus. I have the Holy Spirit living in me. I have His presence all around me. I choose to live in the..." Thankfully, I've got it written down. "I choose to live in your love. Hey, I choose to love people. I choose to have joy instead of being grumpy." Oh, it's going to be a challenge tomorrow for some. "I choose to live in peace." That might be challenging for some people as well, because you just feel like things are stirred up and they're all over the shop. "I choose to have patience." And the Bible says it's not just about the waiting, it's about what you do while you wait. And the Bible makes it hard sometimes, eh? You know, what do you mean I have to wait a certain way? Yeah, you do. Anyway, goodness, kindness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. Against such things there is no law. Because they, you know, the Holy Spirit, those things are operating in your new life. You are fulfilling the plan. You are bringing the glory of God, the kingdom of heaven, into this place. Let's pray. Father, we just want to thank you for this morning. I thank you, Father, that, you know, you are Lord of all. And we choose to worship you, Father. We choose to sit in the chair of saying, "Yes, Lord," regardless of what's happening. I choose beforehand, Lord, to say yes to you. I don't want to see how I feel in the morning, because we know what it's like. You know, we choose to say thank you, Lord, that your mercies are new every morning, and we can wake up in that, and that you forgive us of our sins and you cleanse us from all unrighteousness. All we have to do is confess our sins, and you are faithful and just to forgive us of our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. And your mercies are new every morning. And I want to wake up in the morning and feel your very presence, even though my flesh doesn't want to get out of bed. It doesn't want to, you know, it just wants to get that intravenous caffeine. But something else, Lord, I want something else to motivate me, to get me out of bed, to get me going. And that is the very presence of the living God, an opportunity to serve you and do something for you tomorrow or this morning. So if you're feeling under the pump today, through this week, you may be suffering from grief or struggling with life. You know, I encourage you to try it out where you predetermine your choice that I'm going to get up in the morning anyway, and I'm going to live in the full presence and power of the Holy Spirit. I'm going to walk in Jesus' name. I'm going to talk in Jesus' name. I'm going to have the fruit of the Spirit, and people are going to know me and see it and sense it and feel it. I thank you, Lord, that the waters of my life, and the Bible talks about living water running out of us, but I pray that my, you know, the water in my life would be sweet because of the cross. And if I'm grumpy or bitter, Lord, show me what's going on. But if that's you this morning, I encourage you, just give it to the Lord and say, "Father, please help me." And you know, God will find you if your heart is fully His. He will find you. He will go to the ends of the earth to find you if you run off. And he will give you instructions. And when He gives you instructions, you choose. "Yes, Lord, I will say yes." So if that's you this morning, I just encourage you, just give it to the Lord. Come and lay it at the foot of the cross. Let Him replace any bitterness, any resentment, any anger, any grief, any sadness. Let him replace that with the sweet water, the sweetness that comes from the cross. Thank you, Lord. So let's just take a moment to do that. Father, I want to pray right now for all of those people who have done that just need you. I pray for the anointing to come and break the yoke off your life right now in Jesus' name. I just speak peace beyond understanding into your life, right into your heart. I pray that the God who understands, because Jesus understands, he was betrayed. He was rejected. He was spat on. He was crucified by his own people, his own creation. He knows. But his loving kindness knows no end. He will never leave us nor forsake us. And I thank you, Lord, as your anointing comes in and breaks the yoke off our lives, Lord, that we don't have to be yoked to this world or to grief or to bitterness or sadness or the rejection or the betrayal. We don't have to be yoked to that anymore. We leave that behind and we choose to be yoked to you, because your burden is easy and your yoke it's light. And you are easy to please, as the Bible says. And that's that we take on you, not the bitterness of this world. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Father. Amen. Well, bless you this morning. Oh, yeah. So, on the 11th of December, we have Apostle Norm MacLeod coming here in the morning. So, we're really looking forward to that. He's just come back from India, and he has seen just amazing things happen, blind people